program is made possible by public television stations and by a grant from Sperry Corporation, computer-based information systems for business, industry, government, and national defense.
North Americans who have visited a tropical rainforest, probably not a large percentage of us, most likely came to this one. Unlike most of the world's rainforests, you can get here. It's accessible. Hi, I'm George Page for Nature, and this is the famous Caribbean National Forest in Puerto Rico. It's the only tropical forest in the U.S. National Forest System and is known here as El Junque, a word from the fierce Carib Indians who once lived here, referring to a good spirit. The tropical forest represents one of the Earth's basic life support systems, ranging from the monsoon jungles of Borneo to the cloud forest of Costa Rica. These forests affect rainfall all over the world. But more importantly, it was here in these natural hothouses where over a span of some 100 million years, a vast proportion of the land-living plants and animals on Earth evolved. It was no accident that Charles Darwin developed his still controversial theories of evolution and natural selection while exploring the tropics. Our film takes us to the Monteverde Forest Preserve of Costa Rica, where our producer and cameraman lived for more than 2 months to make this beautiful film, Forest in the Clouds. Tropical forest. Could we ever, from the building blocks of tree and bush, create such a living cathedral? Such a dream can only be a dream. Behind this facade of greenery, there's a world of life of whose complexity we know little and at whose wonders of design and function we can only marvel. It's a world of color and pattern, of strange shapes and even stranger ways. A world where the familiar wears a gaudy coat and the unfamiliar startles with its novelty. It's a hunter's realm where those who eat stalk those who may be eaten. An incessant world of birth, existence, and death. It took 60 million years to build. It's a wilderness of wood soaking in humid, frost-free air, at one time or another the home of most of the land creatures and plants of our planet, depths in which we had our own beginnings. The patchy remnants of the great forest that once spread right across the lands between the tropics now total a mere 3 million square miles. In the last 150 years, we've taken from the forest our rubber, cocoa, coffee, gums, oils and resins, medicines and timber. And at the same time, we've cleared the forest away for room to live. Of the dwindling forests that remain, the Amazonian is the largest, but there are other vital remnants, like the forests of Costa Rica on the land bridge joining the Americas. These forests grew on the slopes of the chain of volcanoes whose eruptions consolidated that land bridge. Poás volcano still provides a glimpse of that violent epoch. 2 million years ago, lava and ash molded the spine of the country, forming the high and fertile slopes which the forest clothed as the craters cooled and flooded in the abundant rain. Over thousands of years, these forests became a living highway for creatures moving north and south between the continents. Some forests are dank and steamy, with many of those qualities exaggerated by fiction writers into visions of an evergreen hell. The jungles of Tarzan or the perils of the Lost World merge in the mind with leafy images of those prehistoric giant tree ferns destined eventually to form our cove. Yet this is a tropical forest too, and it's only a few miles away from that evergreen world of the high slopes. A lowland forest, close to the west coast, has shed its leaves because of a long dry season. At first, it looks like a northern forest in winter, but the twisted vines, mahogany trees, heat, humidity, and the rasp of insects dispel that image. So do the ant and termite nests and other distinctive tropical tree dwellers. Hightailing through the trees, a spider monkey pauses over a waterhole. Clearly visible in this leafless world, an agouti risks a drink. A solitary coatimundi slakes his thirst. Each is alert to danger in this haunt of jaguar and deadly snake. In this setting, each is more vulnerable than under the cover of the dark evergreen forest, where they'll be heard, but seldom so easily seen. A family of peccaries has come to drink. Like the others, these wild pigs and even the larger tapir would be hard to spot in the evergreen forest, where they dig about for fruits and roots in the undergrowth. The seasonal scarcity of water here brings creatures daily to such a stream. In comes a troop of howler monkeys. The big-throated roar of a male howler proclaiming the territory of his clan can be quite alarming and is often mistaken for that of a jaguar. Such a threatening cry in the dense leafy canopy of the evergreen forests is doubly frightening because, unlike here, the animals are then quite hidden as they move. Similar creatures in different types of forest, yet each forest merging into the other, and this dry season world greatly dependent on what little water reaches it from those high, wet forests that pluck their moisture from the clouds. From the heart of the wind-blown mist, the forest takes its water, the element that gives it life. On mosses and filmy ferns, myriad droplets coalesce to a single drop, again and again and again. Long drip tips on the leaves hasten the flow over their surfaces. The whole forest is weeping its own wetness. Such a condensation drip can produce as much as 100 times more water than a direct rainfall. There are no fish to snap at these insects in this high cloud forest stream. The forest is thrifty about how much of this water flows away downhill to the dry lowland. But without the forest, what streams there are would not exist at all. The rich cloak of leafy epiphytes and the copious blankets of sodden moss hold the moisture close to the trees and prevent much of it from streaming to the ground. In this humid, gloomy, even-temperatured hothouse, the exuberance of tropical life is forced to the full. At first glance, much of the forest looks alike, and the place seems quite a random tangle, but there is order here. You could hide a 15-story building among these giant tropical oaks. Cut a slice through a forest and there are a number of layers. Below the tallest trees, there are trees whose crowns form a closed canopy. And below that, a more open layer of shorter trees. And then a layer of tree ferns and palms covering the sparse undergrowth of the forest floor. Each animal and plant in the forest is adjusted to an optimum existence somewhere at a particular level. It's a three-dimensional framework, festooned with the richest assemblage of life on Earth, but where everything has its own place and function. Only 1/100th of the direct sunlight filters to the forest floor, but leaves down here are designed to function in poor light. This underworld is deceptively quiet, for this is the busy recycling plant of the forest. New limbs for old. Nothing must lie around here for long or its goodness will be washed away. Fungi scatter spores from strange excrescences, yet each fruiting body is just the reproductive part of a far-spreading tangle of microscopic threads absorbing nutrients from the dying vegetation. Beneath this fungal tableau, threads reach to the roots of living trees and aid the quick salvaging of the nourishing products of decay. Valuable nitrates, phosphates, vital trace elements are returned to the living world. Here it takes just a few weeks for a leaf to vanish. In a northern forest, the much deeper litter can lie for many months. There are horrors here, if you happen to be frightened of spiders. Some things tend to be big in the tropics. In fact, this spider, out from its burrow, is rather a handsome beast. Fables of giant spiders and vicious scorpions that will kill you with a single stroke of their tails are the stock in trade of the jungle adventure writer. Certainly, this nocturnal hunter is no fun in your bed, and that's where they often get. But in its rightful setting, its sting is a useful defense. This female scorpion, disturbed from its daytime hiding place, is carrying its brood of tiny babies. each by now complete with its own loaded sting. They'll ride protected like this for a week or so. The forest floor is full of surprises. The horn-like ears of the nine-banded armadillo are constantly alert for danger as it grubs about in the undergrowth for insects, larvae, and worms. Like the sloth and the anteater, you'll only find it in the jungles of Central and South America. There's no shortage of insect food on the ground floor, but there's plenty of competition for it. Few creatures wish to get entangled with the notorious army ants. This column, marching with instinctive determination, reaches out 100 yards or so from a temporary underground nest or bivouac made of their own living bodies. Quite blind, they sortie out in quest for food along a scent trail. They'll return along the same path, dragging their booty. The 3-inch wide column of the worker army ants is patrolled by huge soldier ants with monstrous mandibles, but they do their share of haulage too. A living bridge gets the column over a difficult gap. The bigger the gap, the more ants will be required to form a living net to keep the relentless march in progress. At the head of the column, the ants fan out over several square yards and climb into the trees and bushes. It's a cleanup operation of the forest, and nothing that blunders into their path will escape this biting, stinging, overwhelming horde. Overpowered by sheer weight of numbers, the victim is dismembered with seemingly surgical precision. The lucky ones scamper away, although running a gauntlet of forest birds that follow the ants as they flush out the undergrowth. A large cricket burrows to safety. Sheer size is no defense. This rhinoceros beetle, as big as your hand, would do well to take wing in this danger area. The ants have been known to kill small snakes, lizards, and nestling birds, but it seems they're unable to dismember such large victims. Only the luckless explorers of fiction met this sort of horrible death. Elsewhere, the vegetarians of the ant world are slicing up the greenery. The leafcutter, or parasol ants, toil night and day like frantic dressmakers, forever cutting out a new pattern. Their clacking scissor jaws wrestle with what to them must be carpet-thick material. Cutting the ground from under its own feet all the time, an ant needs all the legs it's got to keep a toehold on the main leaf, or a fellow ant. Up, up and away with a piece the size of a quarter. Each cutter joins the long scent trail winding back to the nest entrance. Below ground, the nest is huge, a labyrinth of galleries and chambers lined with a spongy mulch made from the finely chopped fragments. In this underground garden, the ants plant a fungus, and stimulated by the ants, the fungus develops tiny fruit-like parts on which the ants feed their larvae. And in this underground shelter, the ants are safe from the tropical deluge above. Some times of the year are wetter than others here, but this forest thrives on water, and when it rains, it really rains. Cloud forest floors can become a morass of mud. Some 9 or 10 feet of rain fall in a year, and that's in addition to the condensation water from the mists. Very little runs to waste in the economy of the jungle. Caught in flowers and leaves, the rain-filled pools of these virtually aquatic flowers might become a bath for a bird or a puddle for a frog. With the ground so wet, there are frogs here that lay eggs directly onto the undergrowth. Such an egg will not get washed away, and it will never produce a tadpole. An entire frog will emerge from this jelly. This wet world is a frog's paradise. While some are camouflaged, others are gaudy, in colors that warn of poisonous skins. The neat nest of Polistes, the paper wasp, has been spattered with rain, even in the sheltered niche of the dead tree to which it's attached. The liquid can soften the papery structure, becoming a hazard for the growing larvae in the cells. Polistes has a practical and spectacular plan for mopping up. These wasps are fastidiously clean and will preen themselves endlessly when returning with food to the nest, wet or dry. When they've flown through the rain, they'll dry themselves in the same way. Drying the nest seems to be an extension of that instinctive personal behavior. Night comes quickly in the tropics. There's little twilight, and the sounds of dusk become a crescendo as darkness envelops the forest. The twin headlamps of tiny click beetles glow in the inky blackness. A cold luminescence, a product of the insect's own chemistry, that keeps the click beetles in contact with each other and heightens one's own awareness that there are other creatures in the dark. Discovered by our lights, a harvest man sucks the juices of a crane fly on an insect-ravaged leaf. Below, a bush cricket bursts slowly from its nymphal skin, a process that takes 4 or 5 vulnerable hours and for which darkness provides the only cover. At night, bush crickets sit boldly on top of the leaves. The patterns would be invisible in darkness. A leaf or 2 mating moths? It's enough to confuse a predator. And this moth can drop to the ground and become invisible against the leaf litter. Tree frogs of the night emerge to replace those about by day. The darkness rings with their voices while their jade bodies crouch camouflaged and their surprisingly conspicuous hearts beat, invisible in the darkness of the cave-like forest. Night frogs never needed the dark melanic skin pigments that protect the daylight frogs. With the approach of dawn, bats return to roost. All night they've plundered the forest, the fruit eaters, the insect catchers, the nectar sippers. Now each bat seeks its roost as the forest echoes at the suddenness of dawn. The glong of the three-wattled bellbird reverberates round tropical oaks whose buttressed trunks have stood for 200 years or more. Each grew from an acorn, but not every acorn or other seed will complete such a course. The few seeds not eaten will germinate quickly. The young saplings begin the long struggle toward the canopy overhead. Few will reach such heights, as there's little light to encourage growth. Climbers are quick to attach to the growing tree, taking advantage of its support. And other plants, too, perch on the young trunk, which is already clad in moss. Few young trees will reach this size. Most just die, and the climbers then transfer to sturdier prospects of reaching the sun. A climber puts all its energy into climbing, and with such good support available for free, such a plant can soon be spreading its own crown high in the canopy. It's the stems of these climbing plants that hang down as lianas or vines, the characteristic curtain that drapes the trees right to the forest floor. Surprisingly open, something like 200 different species of trees can be in view from any point. 20 would be a likelier number in a temperate forest. A diversity of trees, echoing the diversity of animals, are all interdependent to the extent that few individual trees could live away from the others. Only when an old tree dies and opens a gap can young trees flourish. In such a natural clearing, as indeed in a small cultivated plot, the forest is able to replace itself. But the first plants to grow, like the Cecropia, are specialized for the task. They grow from long dormant seeds, which, triggered by the light, explode into the dense wall of jungle that daunted early explorers. The forest is thickest along the banks of rivers. Behind this secondary growth, there's the more open vegetation of what's termed the climax forest community. In a gap, this type of forest will in time replace that initial fast secondary growth. And no one patch of tropical forest is exactly identical. Changes of soil, altitude, and local climate, and the number of plant eaters, cause subtle variations in the balance of the plant and animal community. This is a curiously familiar place. These are the tropical plants we've learned to live with in our homes and offices. There are plants that can be eaten here and plants that protect their leaves with poison. The processionary caterpillars know which part of this salad they can safely take. The leaves have fattened in the light, and the caterpillars consume the produce, ready soon to change into winged food, destined for other mouths further up the food chain. When that leaf is gone, they move off processionarily, a branch line to the next meal. Not all leaves are leaves. That one in the middle is, in fact, a bush cricket. This stick insect is more easily spotted. The possibilities of disguise are exploited to the full. A moving bird dropping? Well, it's probably the last thing a bird would eat. A multitude of insects and a multitude of flowers for cross-pollination. In this perpetual midsummer, there is no such thing as a spring bloom. Flowers appear as and when each tree and plant species, in a way, senses that its optimum moment of reproducing has come. The competitive struggle to set seed has led to the evolution of intriguing strategies. Having bright flowers to attract pollinators is one, though expensive in terms of energy used by the plant. Another strategy is for a tree to bear its own flowers straight out of the trunk. That way, they're more accessible to creatures crawling from the ground. Only one of the flowers on this bromeliad spike may open for pollination each day. It pays a plant to conserve its energy. Another strategy is to flower when others are not. That way, all the pollinators come to you. And it pays in this constant climate to be a specialist. Hummingbirds and some plants have subtly co-evolved to match need for need. The bird must have a constant supply of energy-rich flight fuel, and the plants continuously put out nectar-rich flowers, a few at a time, satisfying that daily need. To the bird, their redness in the gloom is irresistible, and their shape fits like a glove. The anthers drop down after a visit and expose the female stigma to the pollen, now on the forehead of the next bird in. A flowerless period, like our temperate winter, would break the relationship, and life would be impossible for the tiny hummer and its family. That minuscule nest of cobweb and lichen is only the size of a 50-cent piece. Small families seem to be the rule in the rainforest. This red-faced spinetail will never be able to feed on a spring flush of insects like that available to a northern forest bird. There's a variety of insects, but no one species is very abundant. So the spinetail and tufted flycatcher and other birds are limited to feeding only a couple of young. To protect that small clutch, nests are built on the extremities of branches, hopefully out of the reach of tree snakes. Hundreds of species of birds inhabit the world's rainforests, and some are remarkably alike. The emerald toucanet is the equivalent of the hornbills of Europe. It nests in living trees. The dead trees of this forest are home to a uniquely American bird. This is one of the rare occasions a resplendent quetzal has been caught on film. Catching more than a shady glimpse of this most elegant of forest birds is a special event. The quetzal was the sacred bird of the Aztecs and the Mayas. As usual, the females are less spectacular than the males. The name quetzal derives from an Aztec word for long-tailed and has since come to mean precious and beautiful. Montezuma gave Cortez a headdress of 170 iridescent plumes, but not one bird was killed. The feathers grow again. The birds take turns to incubate the eggs. Once listed as extinct and thought as fabulous as the phoenix, the secretive quetzal is very much alive in these high forests. The leafy canopy of the forest is its powerhouse, basking in the full tropical glare and absorbing energy directly from the sun. And it's a penthouse garden hung with epiphytes, plants that merely perch on the trees but in no way feed off them. Relatives of the pineapple, the bromeliad, sit and stare at the sun, and within each rosette of leaves, there's a whole self-contained world of tiny creatures. On and under each leaf, something is finding a living. Each of the dozens of different animals confined to the plant probably knows no other world than the microcosm between the leaves. The forest floor is a long, long way below. Many of the creatures only emerge onto the leaves at night. By day, the desiccating heat forces the inhabitants to seek the dark recesses of the leaf bases. This damp world of rotting vegetation caught in the rosette is the haunt of frogs and weevils, spiders and millipedes, hunters and hunted in a mini jungle of their own. A tiny salamander, only as long as a matchstick, slides through the mulch of plant remains. The bromeliad must retain moisture, and the leaves over which insect larvae slide are covered with special cells that prevent water escaping in dry periods, but which quickly absorb any dew or rain that washes over them. A private pond at the heart of the bromeliad holds other beasts. This rat-tailed larva will hatch into a fly but spends its youth snorkeling in a natural tank. The water trapped by the leaves squirms with microscopic life. A rich and ever-thickening soup for others to thrive on. Each bromeliad is a closed community subject to heat, drought, and flood. It's quite self-supporting, and apart from one African species, a unique feature of the New World jungles. The forest has been called the last home of mystery, and most of the mysteries involve several individuals. This is a fern, not instantly recognizable until you spot its leaves, which are reasonably fern-like. Its stem straggles along a branch of a tree, and here and there these so-called tubers form. They got it the name potato fern. Touch them and you're likely to get bitten by a ferocious ant. The tubers are hollow. There's an entrance in this pit. The ants use the tuber as a breeding chamber, stocking it with their larvae. The ants feed on the sweet tissue of a growing tuber, which helps to hollow it out. Subsequently, other insects may also breed in here, and the whole chamber can absorb moisture and act as a reservoir. Sometimes there are no ants at all. It's a fascinating relationship, and as yet still surrounded by a good deal of mystery. As is the phenomenon known as an ant garden. It's an ant nest on a tree, and certain plants are invariably associated with the structure. The top is quite clear and well manicured by the ants, which emerge at any touch. At least one of the three ant garden plants may well be planted by the ants themselves. Its roots may help to bind the nest together. The gardeners are quick to move away any rubbish and to see off any intruder. Perhaps the supporting tree benefits by the ants repelling potential leaf eaters. The canopy is a highway, though the traffic may be slow. The sloth ambles around, forever upside down. It moves in search of some edible leaves and whatever fruits happen to be ripe. Again, the lack of a universal seasonality means that even individual trees of the same species fruit at different times, each to its own season. That way, the sloth, the fruit-eating quetzal, and the other canopy dwellers can't really anticipate where the next meal will appear. The howlers have found a fig tree laden with thousands of tiny ripe fruit. Fig trees are often forest giants, head and shoulders above the canopy. There are dozens of different species, but they all share a common secret. Each is entirely dependent on a tiny wasp, a millimeter or so long. Some figs grow from seed in the forest floor. Others, called stranglers, have a more sinister story. Stranglers can be huge, and their strange, ropey trunks can be of quite enormous girth. Such a giant starts life from a tiny seed, perhaps dropped by a howler monkey high on a tree branch. It grows and sends down a single root to the forest floor. Once that root is functioning, the young fig grows very quickly and will send down other roots on all sides of the supporting trunk. Those roots will grow and thicken, and where they touch, they'll fuse together. Inside the latticework tube, the support tree can't grow and expand. It's literally strangled to death. In time, it rots, leaving the hollow girder of the living fig tree empty. It's large enough inside for a man to climb the 100 feet or so to the crown, and a potential home for porcupines or snakes. The actual figs of each species differ in shape and size. These are about as big as cherries. A fig is not really a fruit. It's a case for the male and female flowers that line the interior. The round objects are the ovaries of the two kinds of female flower. The male flowers, as yet unripe, sit between. Outside the fig, a minute wasp, a couple of millimeters long, is struggling to get in. That's its rear end. It's a female wasp, and she sheds her wings as she burrows. Inside, she performs two tasks. In each of the female flowers of one type, she lays an egg. As she does so, the pollen, carried in pockets on her body, is also dusted onto the other type of female flowers, which will develop seeds. Then she dies, along with three or four others which perform the same tasks. In the now airtight fig, the gallflowers swell with the developing insects, and in the other ovaries, the seeds ripen. Take the lid off the gallflowers, and the wasp pupae are revealed. 20 to 100 or so days later, according to species, wasps appear, all the males first, wingless, and also with two jobs to perform. First, they must locate an unhatched female wasp and mate with her while she's still inside the gallflower. And after that, they must burrow and exit to the surface of the fig, although they may not actually go out. Air now enters the fig through the male's burrow, and the raised oxygen level within triggers the hatching of all the females. Between the empty cells and the seed flowers, the male flowers are now opening. The white pairs of anthers give off a scent which attracts the female wasps, and they actively pluck the pollen with their front legs and fill their special pockets. The females then leave through the hole bored by the males. A 100 wasps or so hatch in every fig, so on this one day from a loaded tree, a vast cloud sets off to find another tree that's at exactly the right stage for the pollination cycle to start again. And the fig tree they seek must be exactly the same species as this one, for every fig tree has its very own type of wasp to pollinate it. The fig, of course, must not ripen yet, or the wasp would be eaten and the cycle broken. Dead males and the bodies of pollinating females litter the fig. They'll not lie for long, as scavenging ants remove the corpses, effectively cleaning up the fig, ready for consumption. Only now does the fig ripen, and the whole tree becomes a focus of attention on the canopy highway. Much fruit will be carried off in full stomachs and the seed dispersed widely in droppings. But the monkeys are messy eaters and scatter half-eaten fruit locally. The opportunists don't miss a trick. Along the ground floor, far below, fig seeds are traveling to the far corners of the forest. And somewhere, another fig will start to grow. This fragile complexity of life took several million years to build, but it can vanish overnight. So fragile is it that if you take out even one tree, a whole interdependent world goes with it. While you've been watching this film, more than 1,000 acres of the world's natural forest have been felled. They cannot be put back. By the end of this century, man may have outlived the vanishing jungle, and many undiscovered wonders will be lost forever. Sadly, every year, some 60,000 square miles of the world's tropical forest are destroyed. That's an area about as large as the whole state of Georgia, cleared for timber, cattle pastures, and human settlements. No one knows for sure what the tearing down of these forests will mean to future generations. But natural scientists are deeply worried and fighting a losing battle to save what's left. I'm George Page for Nature.
This was our final program in this season's Nature Presentations. We hope you've enjoyed the series and suggest that you join us next Sunday night at 7 for the premiere of the series Living Wild and a fascinating look at the Antarctic summer. This program was made possible by public television stations and by a grant from Sperry Corporation.